attention to the book of, to the epistles of 1 Peter, chapter 2. 1 Peter in chapter 2. And let me read for you verse number 6. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. The word confounded has been translated, shall not be put to shame. It's also translated, shall not be disappointed. So let me read that once again. Wherefore also it is contained in the scriptures, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be put to shame. This is one passage that has been used repeatedly in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. I believe Psalm 118 very strongly speaks about it. I believe, you know, Jacob's prophesy over Joseph has this word stone indicating God in that particular prophetic word. But I was so moved today as I read the context in which this passage was given. This is a quotation that Peter uses, and Jesus himself used it a few times in the Word of God. You know, the context in which it was used is Isaiah. It's from the book of Isaiah, chapter 28. It's very profound. Isaiah chapter 28 and verse number 16. That's where, you know, Peter uses this particular passage from. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone. Look at the descriptive words used about the stone. A tried stone. A precious corner stone. A sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. The word haste is a very particular word. It's a very descriptive word, meaning the person who believes on the stone will not be agitated, will have a certain sense of restfulness in God. Can I get an agreement here? But I want to take for a moment the context in which Isaiah brings this particular prophetic word. This is very interesting. In the book of Isaiah chapter, I believe right from chapter 10 onwards, or maybe even before that, there is an imminent threat coming from one of the greatest army of those days, if not the greatest, called the Assyrian army. They were very, very heinous in their crimes. The atrocities that they committed against humanity were recorded in the annals of history. There were an army that would come into a place and almost with fear paralyze the entire nation, even the strong men of the land. And imagine such an enemy at your doorstep, about to march in any moment. And you can only imagine the psychosis of fear that might be in that place when you know the little ones would be brutally murdered or taken as slaves by the Assyrian army. Now listen carefully. At that point of time, you know, Israel is now trying to find a way to overcome this imminent disaster. And it came to a point, they found the king of Egypt was willing to help Israel. The king of Egypt promised a certain kind of an agreement with Israel to help Israel for a certain kind of a price. Now Israel is about to take that particular route in which they will find an agreement with the king of Egypt. Israel, an alliance will be formed, Egypt, an alliance will be formed, and thus they would be able to kind of resist the invading army. But at that point of time, God sends prophet Isaiah and says, do not get into this agreement. Do not get into this agreement. Because if you get into this agreement, it's only going to become much more worse. But just trust God. Trust God and all will be fine. Now, how many of you know sometimes these words are just words that comes across as more, you know, a slogan, a kind of a cliche. Trust God and everything will be fine. When you are in a situation where, you know, next day would mean death or life, you cannot take that as a slogan. You have to put your life on that. Either you do that or you don't do that. And Israel was very unwilling to trust God in that situation. God kept on telling the prophets, through the prophets, tell them, do not get afraid. I will fight your battle. Amen. But Israel could not take it. So what they did was, God said, they wanted the blueprint. So God said, this is how I'm going to give you the blueprint. Now listen carefully. Whenever we are in a situation that is imminent, could be an imminent threat to our lives, we want God to give us a full the blueprint of the entire situation, how he's going to handle it. Sometimes God doesn't do that. Instead of that, he gave them a word, and this is a word he gave them. He said in verse number 10 of Isaiah 28. Now listen carefully, Isaiah 28, verse number 10. Precept upon precept. Precept upon precept. Line upon line. Line upon line. Here a little, there a little. This is how God is going to speak. He's not going to give you the entire blueprint in its entirety, but he will give you one line, and the other line will be superseded with this line. This line will kind of confirm the other line. He will send one prophet and send another prophet to confirm what the earlier prophet said, and that's how he was speaking to his people. Let me tell you, every time God speaks to his people, it will be confirmed upon confirmation upon confirmation. He will bring line upon line, precepts upon precepts, and thus he will give you a certain understanding of what he's about to do. That's the way he ministers. But look at this. This is a very sorry state, and I was absolutely baffled in my spirit. And to a certain extent, a trepidation came over me, because that's how we most of the time deal with God's word. This is what they did. In verse number 13, look, they used God's word and what God said and made fun out of. They started to deride the word of God, became scornful towards it. Verse number 13. But the word of the Lord was unto them, precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line. Here a little, there a little. You know what? They used what God said and made a song out of it in derision. This is how it comes across in Hebrew language. This is how it's there's a rhyming to it. Savo lot savo, savo lot savo, kavo la kavo, kavo la kavo. They are making fun of what God is saying. Because in Hebrew it comes across as savo lot savo, kavo la kavo, kavo la kavo. They said, God, is there nothing else you want to speak to us? All about this precept upon precept, line upon line, sawa kasawa. What is this? When we are in a place of imminent danger, you're giving us some kind of, one-liners. Doesn't make sense. So what they did was, they decided to go in an agreement with Egypt. And look at what God says about it. Verse number 15. I want you to understand this, people of God. 15. Because you have said, you have made a covenant with death. Anytime we come outside of trusting God and trusting in our own means, in our own situations around us, God calls it a covenant of death. How many of you know we in this country, many a times when God says something, we immediately try to project things into an available scope of potentially how we would handle it. Or we would just immediately connect it to the natural means and the rationalization and the logic connected to it. But let me tell you, sometimes there is no logic. Sometimes there is no reasoning. Sometimes there's no natural scope in order for you to comprehend it. But remember, God's word is God's word. What he said, he will do it. No matter whether you see it in the natural, even for you to comprehend it, if you can trust him, the Lord says, I will do just as what I said, because my ways are higher than your ways. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. But these people could not comprehend or even fathom what God was saying, because God did not give them some kind of a dramatic, spectacular, you know, sign in heaven. He just gave them his word. But they said, we cannot hear your word. Instead of that, we will make this agreement. And the Bible calls it, God calls it, the agreement with death. And the Lord says, and with hell are we at agreement. When you are not living a life of faith, you're making an agreement with death. And when the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it will not come into us. You know what they're saying? When this huge Assyrian army will come like a deluge, like a flood, it will not pass through over us. Because we have made lies our refuge. And we have made falsehood. And we have hid ourselves under falsehood. Nothing is going to happen. We have Pharaoh to support us. Now let me make this very clear. You may ask me, Pastor, what do you mean? What is a sign of a person who trusts God? I want to give you two important truths and then want to bring the bearing on this particular passage, and we are going to pray today. Listen closely. What is a sign of a person? In the context of the same situation, this is what God says. In Isaiah chapter 30 and verse number 15. This is the same context, believe me. Isaiah 30, I'm sorry, not 1-3, 30. 3-0-15. 15, please. For thus says the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest, you shall be saved. In quietness and in confidence shall be your strength, and you would not. God said, you just have to come back and rest in my promise. I will do the rest. Let me ask you, how many of you can believe your God today? No, you didn't hear that. How many of you believe God? Even when I don't see signs, I know you are a faithful God. You are a merciful God. You are a promise-keeping God. Can I get an agreement in the house of the Lord? Just to trust in him and to rest in his promise. God said, that's all what you need to do. You don't have to go into the supernatural, spiritual gymnastic of how to, you know, somehow you have to do some kind of a, you know, some kind of an exercise of faith. You just have to rest in me. I will do the rest. But they wouldn't. So in the sign of somebody who would not rest in God, next verse will explain to us. That's the word. Two things. But you said, no, we will flee upon horses. God says, stay. I will take care of you. And you say, we will flee upon horses. Let me tell you, some of us have made a predisposition towards defeat. We have made an agreement with defeat and failure. We have already decided in our minds, when we are even listening to God's word, that things are going to fall apart and somehow we have to find a way to escape. But let me make this very clear. Today I sense in my spirit every agreement with death and hell need to be destroyed in the name of Jesus, and there need to be a renewed agreement with the word of God that will not be shaken. Come on, somebody. Can I get a sound of amen today? I repeat that word once again. Every agreement of unbelief made with death and destruction and defeat has to be terminated tonight. There has to be a renunciation of such agreement, and there must be a renewed agreement with the word that will never change, the word of God and God himself. How many of you want to say, we agree with victory, we agree with healing, we agree with miracle, we agree with the promises of God? God said it and it shall be so. Look what it says. This is a very, very interesting kind of a mysterious kind of a passage. But I tell you, people of God, that would explain to me a lot of mystery in itself. Look what it says. But you said, no, for we will flee upon horses. Therefore shall you flee. God said, you're not fleeing because the enemy came. Because you said it. You said it. Some of you have made an agreement with death and defeat by your tongue. You said you're going to be sick. You said your children are not going to prosper. You said it, and because of that, it's happening. Tonight I'm here to announce, let's revoke every agreement with Satan and with death in the name of Jesus. And today some of you need to say, I am victorious. My future is blessed in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. You said it. You said we will. God said relax and rest. You said no, we will flee. We will have to flee. And because of that, you will flee. But look at the next verse. And we will ride upon the swift. They said we will go on the wings of wind. We will flee. Look at these people. Jewish people are intelligent. They're looking at all avenue of escape. We will ride on swift. But look what God said. Therefore shall they that pursue you be swift. That means when you started speaking words of unbelief, your enemy received speed. It was your word that gave the enemy more speed. How many of you know the Bible says the enemy has been defeated on the cross? His weapons have been taken away from him. Come on, he has been paralyzed. The Greek word for Jesus stripped him. You know what it means? It means that he's paralyzed. He is now on a wheelchair. But some days I think, my goodness, the enemy on a wheelchair. How did that enemy become so fast? God told me it was not that the enemy had speed. My people gave the enemy speed. When you said we will flee in unbelief and we will outrun the enemy, the enemy received new speed. Your unbelief will increase the speed and accelerate the defeat that's going to come, and the enemy gets much more faster. But tonight, your faith, when you rest on the Lord, even the enemy that comes close to you will be paralyzed. Oh, can I get somebody who can trust in the Lord, wait upon the promise of God, and say, I believe God's word, no matter what I see, no matter how hard the situation is, I believe my God is a faithful, faithful God. And when you rest on Him, the enemy that came faster towards you will be arrested and will be gripped with a holy fear. Come on. You gave speed to the enemy by what you said. If you had sat resting in me, instead of looking at the enemy and speaking words of defeat and failure and negativity, the enemy wouldn't have had the upper hand on you. Today, I'm here. I keep on hearing the word. You, as a servant of a living God, cancel every agreement that the people have made with death and with hell. How many of you want to say a mighty amen to Jesus and His word and cancel the contract with the enemy? Come on, if you can do that, I want you to put your hands together, give a Lord of praise in the house of the Lord. You made that word. But look at this. Look at this. The next word is powerful. Oh, let me say this. 1,000 shall flee at the rebuke of one. Do you know there is a inverting? There is what you call a turning around of a promise? Because in Deuteronomy chapter 32, 30, I believe, and Leviticus 28, I believe, God said, one of you shall chase 1,000. Five of you shall chase 10,000. God said that as a promise, because God is with you. His word is with you. God is fighting your battle. But when you started moving in unbelief, one enemy can chase 1,000 believers. You know what? If you are not careful, this is a very powerful word. I'm speaking from the bottom of my heart. If you are not careful, every promise that God gave you will become a tool in the hands of the enemy. How many of you know what David did in destroying Goliath? David went and took Goliath's weapon and used it against Goliath. Come on. And this is exactly what the enemy does. A promise which was yours, he will take it from you because you are now rejecting that promise on the basis of unbelief. And he will use it against you. This was a promise that God gave Israelites. One of you shall chase 1,000. Two of you shall chase 10,000. Five in the book of Leviticus. But the enemy uses the same promise which was yours. And is attacking the church back. One enemy is now attacking 1,000 believers. And I want to make an assertion here. Please don't get me wrong. That is the state of believers and churches in many parts of this nation. The enemy that should have been put to flight is now making the believers run. One enemy, one little problem, we run before the enemy can even open his mouth. But I hear today in the name of Jesus, let this Lord's table be a moment where we are going to let our faith rise up again and reestablish our faith in Christ Jesus and say, one of us shall chase 1,000 demons. Come on, can I get a witness in the house of the Lord? One of you shall chase 1,000 demons and two of you shall chase 10,000 in the name of Jesus. That anointing is coming back upon the church. The enemy took a promise which was yours and is attacking you with the same promise by which you should have attacked the enemy. One of you shall chase 1,000 was yours. But now the enemy is using it against you. And I tell you with great pain, let me say, that is now the state of many of our people. The authority which was yours, the enemy is using it against you. The power which was yours, the enemy is using it against you. The anointing which was yours, the enemy is using it against you. Because you could not believe God. And today, by believing God and His Word, we are reclaiming what is rightfully ours in the name. How many of you want to declare with a mighty shout of praise that the enemy has no more claim over your life? Your promise is your promise. Your victory is your victory. Your anointing is your anointing. Your authority is your authority. If you believe that, put your hands together. Give the Lord a praise in the house of the Lord. You know what? I gave him the tool. He does not have the weapon. Because Jesus stripped him of every weapon. But I gave him the tool. But today I'm regaining it. I'm taking back what belongs to me and to my family and to my life. If you believe that, shout a hallelujah. So God said, you have two ways of dealing with it. Either you agree with Pharaoh and find a convenient, logical, rational way of escaping this problem. But if you do that, you're making a kind of an implicit agreement with death itself. The final will be death. You know, I want you to know, I've seen this often. People, when they go through trouble, immediately they'll start to think logically. And at that point, FM, God is out of the picture. Danger. Because if without even knowing inadvertently, you're agreeing with destruction and death. That's one choice. The other choice is this. God said, you can either go and make an agreement with Pharaoh and get destroyed. And they did. After 2 years, Assyrians came and took all the children as slaves. They did. Or, behold, I lay a stone in Zion. And Jesus said, I am that stone. I heard two or three words about that stone. One is, it's a cornerstone. I don't have much time to declare it. Cornerstone. You know what it means? I don't know whether that's something that is common here, but coming from a place like India, we used to have cornerstones that would see that every other stones are held together. The cornerstones must be strong enough, big enough. And 1 Kings 5:17, the Bible says Solomon hewed cornerstones, foundation stones that were big and costly. And that stone will keep all the other stones together. And let me tell you, Jesus Christ is that foundational stone. One of the passages that has been ministering to me for days now is from Colossians 1:17, where the Bible says, all things are held together in Him. In Him all things consist. You know, for those of you who have a scientific kind of inclination or mind, let me just read this for you. This came from a man who has also written, the man who discovered or in fact wrote about the Big Bang Theory. This is what they say. It, in this book called The Atom Speaks, D. Lee Chesnut, a nuclear physicist. This is what he says. How many of you know the Coulomb's law of electromagnetic rules and laws where, you know, unlike particles attract, the same, they repel. You cannot have a positive with a positive. It'll repel. That's magnetic law, the Coulomb's law of magnetism. And then the unlike would attract. You need a positive with a negative to bring it together. But when they found the nucleus of an atom, and even the nucleus of a oxygen atom nucleus, you know what they found? There are eight protons, all positive. But do you know there is no negative there? There's no negative. There's only protons. And then you have got neutrons, eight of them. But that's insignificant. But the protons, eight positive charged protons are held together. And scientists don't have a clue. And they call it the nuclear energy or the nuclear binding force. You know what this great scientist said? Because every article is made of atoms. He said, every item on this planet, including this bottle, including anything, including me or anybody, any article has got the potential to become a nuclear device. It can explode. This chair can become a nuclear device. This mic can become a nuclear device because protons can explode. They're all positive, but something is holding it. Something is holding it, and they call it the binding force of, they call it nuclear force. That's a term, but nobody knows why. And I know why. The reason nothing is exploding, because He is holding. And I heard the Lord say, the God who holds this universe from exploding, He holds this earth from exploding. He can hold your family. He can hold your children. He can hold your future. He can hold your finance. Come on, somebody, lift up your voice. He can hold you completely from exploding. If you can believe Jesus Christ holds your life, can you give a Lord a praise in the house of the Lord? He holds your life together. You know what it means? Every event that happened in your life, every event that is still happening in your life, and every event that will happen in your life are not happening in isolation. It's all controlled. He has got a proton. You say, God, this experience of mine cannot connect with this experience of mine because one is, you know, doesn't fit. But God says, even the painful experience of your life, I have put it together and I'm holding it. And when it is all done, at the end of the day, it will be so beautiful. It'll be so glorious. How many of you are willing to say, my life is held, not because I'm smart. You cannot control. Let me tell you, you cannot even control your own health. You cannot even control even the way your eye would blink. Even some kind of disorder for which medical science has not even, you know, got a way of understanding it. But with all that, day or night, in any situation, somebody is holding my life. So can people of God today who has experienced this foundation stone, can you make with a joy in your heart a statement which every demon in hell must hear, that your life is held, your past, your present, your future, the seen and the unseen. People connected to you, people who are near and far away, everything is held together by this cornerstone called Jesus. If you believe that, can you make, come on, you can do better. He holds it. Nothing will happen without his knowledge. If you believe that, put your hands together. Give a Lord a praise in the house of the Lord. He holds it together. Come on. Let me ask you, how many of you prayed today for the billions of atoms from exploding? You didn't. And let me tell you, the chances of that exploding is very possible. And that's the reason Peter's book, it says, finally, he will just remove his hand and then the molecules will melt. That day is coming. But now he's holding it. 8 protons without an electron cannot survive together. It's against science. But that is what is seen throughout the universe. And the Big Bang Theory man says, every item on this planet, even in your household, is potentially a nuclear device. It can explode. But somebody is not allowing that to explode. And let me tell you, the nuclear people call it some kind of a nuclear force. They don't know what is holding it. They don't know anything better. But I know who is holding it. It's not a force. It is a person. So once again, can I hear a strong affirmation of people who believe the Lord who holds the nucleus, the atom together, can hold my life together? If you can believe that, or you can do better, he will hold my future, he will hold my past, he will hold the unseen future. Come on, lift up your voice and shout a hallelujah. Oh, Rabbi Shantaloria. He holds, he's a cornerstone. But the Bible says, he's a precious cornerstone. He's a pearl. Oh no, he's more costly than a pearl. There's nothing as precious as him. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. And then it says it's a tested stone. I tell you what it means. Tested. It means anybody that has put their trust in him, you can test through the ages. Doesn't mean that they didn't go through fire. Doesn't mean that they didn't go through water. But it means at the end of a day, not one person can say, he failed me. Jesus has never failed me even once. Amen. He's tested. Abraham tested him, found him faithful. David tested him and said, he's my refuge. Every saint of God that tested him have proved that he is faithful. That is a stone. It's a sure foundation. When everything else will shake, He does not shake. He remains the same. Somebody said Peter is a rock on which the church is built. I tell you, if Peter is a rock, I am on shaky ground. Because one moment he can say something, another moment he'll change the whole thing. Come on, I don't want Peter to be my rock. Jesus is a rock. And because Jesus is a rock, the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church of a living God. Israel has got two options. Either trust Pharaoh and sign your death warrant, or put your trust on this rock. It's a precious rock. It's a cornerstone. It's tested. I tell you, the devil looked at him and said, "You are the Son of a living God." Pilate looked at him and said, "There is no fault in him. He is pure." God said from heaven, "This is my beloved Son." Everybody that tested him gave a clean chit. He is the Lamb of God. But he is also the cornerstone, a sure foundation. And anybody that believes on him shall not be put to shame. But I was moved today when I read the word shame in the Greek. You know what? How many of you know? Let me just say this one more word and then we'll go into Lord's table. How many of you know, most of the time our thinking is more psychological. Meaning, for us, if you talk about shame, disappointment, it's all about a feeling, right? A feeling. I felt irritated, I felt angry, I felt upset, I felt, kind of deflated. It's all your feeling. But you know what? God doesn't care about your feelings. It's not about the feeling. Because you can have one feeling today and tomorrow you'll have another feeling. But the word used over there, you have to start seeing that from a Hebrew perspective. You know what it means? It means, in a public setting, if you have declared your faith in God, God will never let his name be put to shame. When God said, "Thou shalt not take my name in vain," you know what it means? It's not about, I know swearing is part of it, but it's not about swearing. He said, if you made a declaration, backed it up with my name, I will come through if it's a rightful declaration. You cannot take anything and back it up with my name. Because once you back it up with my name, you cannot put my name into shame. You know, the Bible says, anybody that trusted him, I'll tell you with great confidence, your friends can watch you. Your family can watch you. The neighborhood can watch you. Nobody will ever say, "Look, he trusted in God. And look, God deserted him." Never. His name will never be put to shame. And the Bible says, anybody that believed on this stone will never be put to shame. If you can believe that, can you, for sake of your family, for the sake of your future, for sake of things that almost is making you feel so worried and afraid, you feel panic in your spirit, can you make a statement today? I want you to do it as clear as you can, that you will never have to run away. You never have to flee. You never have to be disappointed because you trusted in him. Can you make it known? Personal. Can you make it known in the house of the Lord? Never be put to shame. If you believe that, put your hands together. You do something that will make your faith known. Never be put to shame because you have trusted the rock of ages, the Spirit of God.